Sure. Rabu, I'm typically a startup guy. I've been with the startup industry since 2011. The company that my co-founder and I have started is IBC Media. IBC Media is an innovation management company. We help innovators connect with large problems through corporate innovation programs, accelerators, incubators. To put it specifically, no one's experienced anything like this, who's been in our industry right now. This is the first time that something of this, its effect is absolute. There's no negotiation about this. So a lot of the people who required outdoor transportation, who needed public gatherings and who needed, congregation and physical spaces have really been affected tremendously. This has in turn taken an effect on the markets and cash and liquidity with companies and investors as well, and that has trickled down to start. COVID, you can very safely say that everything is 10 times tougher and everything will take 10 times longer, and be it customer acquisition, funding. If you kind of boil it down to the core of the problem, what has changed is it's forced a specific kind of change, the pandemic, but that has also come up with several new opportunities. So you are seeing a lot of new startups coming up today who are solving for life after COVID. One interesting startup, for example, has a temperature sensor that can ubiquitously identify people who are showing symptoms of COVID. So those kind of companies are coming up a lot more. Telecommunication obviously is going through the roof, recovering from shock right now. No? So some things are standing out. Definitely, remote working is a thing that a lot more people are taking pretty seriously. What is sad is that it took a pandemic to realize that most IT work can be done remotely, and it doesn't require people spending arduous amounts of time getting to work. Also now funding requirements will not always be grow. I think there will be a lot greater focus on sustainability, and that will now come to the forefront, because at the end of the day, what you need to survive a situation like this is cash. And startups will start thinking about that a lot earlier than what they are right now. That's what I think about this mess that we're in. I think that technology has ever been the issue. Technically, we could do everything that we're doing on Skype or on Hangouts or on BlueJeans or GoToMeeting or Cisco WebEx. I don't think it's the tool problem at all. It's a process issue. Companies that are working remotely need to consider good remote working practices, which is have objective stand-up calls, have follow a strong project management approach. And I'm not a fan of one over the other. It's just have an approach that everybody adheres to. Have set communication protocols that everybody can adhere to, and over communicate as much as possible, be objective about how you measure employee performance, not about how long they were online or how long they spent at office. Be very clear about, okay, what were they hired for, what are their KPIs and what they do. So I think it's more of a process issue. The tools and technologies, I honestly think there are too many of them. Something that's brewing for a while right now. Programming is going to be the next English, right? And at one point, if you wanted the world to open up to you, you needed to be well versed in the English language. Today, I think there is equal if not more value in being able to program. I think that's the next big thing that everybody is going to have to learn. You must know how this digital ecosystem works. So I foresee that being the biggest skill, number one. Two, I think growth marketers are going to be more important now than ever. And I don't mean that just the typical SEO Facebook ad type guys, but actual marketers who can help companies grow or find companies new business in the most efficient way. I think that the demand for them has always been high, but now more so than ever. Thirdly, I think the quant and math guys who can do a lot of data analysis right now, there is, if you are a sizable digital company, I think that there is enough data for you to kind of read into and come up with you know, actionable insights. I think that a lot more companies will need that as a core skill across any kind of job description, be it HR, marketing, sales, development, account, name it. So I think data analysis, programming, and growth, I would say that these three things, at least in the startup industry, there will be a lot more emphasis on that than what has been so far. That's a very pertinent question right now. And it's been a question that has plagued us. The guys who are in the urban settings, there's always been an abundance of opportunity, but now more so than ever, we are at the same level as anybody else. Jobs are going to be a lot harder to come by. And this time, it's probably nobody owes you a job. I think that's the first thing that you have to keep that in mind, right? You are working for a profit-making enterprise, and you have to think of where you fit into that space, where you can add value to that. And work backwards from there. It should be an alignment of what you like to do and what you're good at, and then find out where that fits into a business. If that place that it fits has a job description, go and apply for those. And approach it from the standpoint that, hey, I am good at this. You need what I am good at for X, Y, and Z, and that's what makes me a good hire. Having that mindset, not only now, but for all kinds of jobs that you apply for, would be far more useful, have and yield higher success rates in terms of closing that job than just thinking that, oh, I finished a degree or I have a certification in a particular thing and so you should hire me. In a market of abundance, you could get away with that, but now every dollar spent is going to be scrutinized. And with keeping that in mind, you have to be certain that your job and your skill is something that adds tremendous value to the company, and then apply for it with that context in mind. Put yourself in the shoes of someone who's actually going to be spending money on you. Would you do it? And if the answer is yes, more often than not, you'll get that job. And if the answer is no, work harder and figure out what is it that you can do to make yourself a lot more employable. But keep this in mind, no one owes you a job. You have to figure out a way of adding value to a profit-making enterprise. And this is not just true for now, probably more pertinent now, but it's not just true for now. It is something that will apply when everything is good and when we are in a market of abundance. But keep that in mind.